landscape trades, Elaine Weber has developed a sixth sense and understanding of plants and landscape systems from a biological perspective. Her early educational focus on biology, botany, and horticulture was later supplemented with a focus on permaculture, soil microbiology, and botanical illustration, all helping her develop her unique skills serving the emerging field of sustainable organic horticulture. In 2001, she expanded her landscape business to include the production of high-grade compost and compost teas. Elaine lectures throughout California on a wide range of topics, all with a focus on the benefits and actions of the soil food web. Elaine is at home in San Mateo, where she was the educational director of her county's master composter program for 10 years, teaching and training the hands-on arts of sustainable gardening through proper backyard composting. So please help me welcome Elaine.
Tonight is learning how to grow an abundant garden without any of the negative side effects that chemicals bring us. And I'm not just talking pesticides, I'm also talking herbicides, as in weed and feed type fertilizers for lawns. And I'm also talking about chemical fertilizers, especially the soluble ones like Miracle-Gro and all of those that we see all these wonderful commercials for. They even sponsor shows on PBS, and I cringe because I know what those chemicals do to the soil. So we're going to be looking at the environmental services that the soil biology offers to all of us. And hopefully I will, if not make your head explode with new information, at least give you something to really wonder about. This information, most of it comes from my teacher and mentor, Dr. Elaine Ingham of the Soil Food Web. She was a professor at Corvallis, Oregon State Corvallis, until they kicked her out for taking up too much lab space when she started a soil microbe testing service. Most of you have heard of soil tests, and these are chemical tests, so they test the soluble chemicals present in the soil. Those are the kinds of chemicals in chemical fertilizers. They're soluble, they're there for a very short time because they wash through quickly, and so most chemical tests come back deficient because with one good rain event, please, we need rain, or a couple normal irrigation events with your sprinklers at home, you wash out all the soluble nutrient that's there from chemical fertilizers. Well, anyway, long story short, we are going to find out how all of these microbes actually support all of the things that we can do, and that they're in enough numbers to actually make a difference. Oh, I remember where I was. So Dr. Ingham got kicked out of the labs at Corvallis and suggested, why don't you move on because you've got this thriving business. And now she has about 12 labs all over the world that test nothing but the actual counts of microbes in the soil. So people send in soil samples, people send in compost samples, compost tea samples. Those of us that make compost tea, we test it regularly to make sure that we're not just selling brown water. You know, you can't see it, it's microscopic. So we want to make sure that it has the protozoa and the nematodes and the bacteria and the fungi that are the really good ones that we want to put out into people's gardens to bring abundance and fertility. So she moved on from academia. Her husband is still a professor at Corvallis. And she now lectures all over the world. She circles the globe 2 or 3 times every year. She's quite an amazing person. So most all of the photographs and scanning electron micrographs that you'll be seeing tonight are courtesy of Dr. Ingham, and she shares her research freely with most of us to get the word out. So with that being said, I just wanted to kind of look a little bit at what is the definition of health. It's very so much, and I kind of wanted to nail that down a bit. So it's full performance within genetic limits. So many of us are used to pushing plants with chemicals past their genetic limits. That's what chemicals allow you to do. Now, we know this example as an analogy from steroid use in athletes. They can push their performance past what is really humanly possible and get that edge with chemicals. Well, there's side effects and there's downside to that. And in the human body, in the ecosystem, in the environment, same thing. There's bad things that happen when we use a lot of chemicals and they build up in the soil. So what can you expect from a natural system where you understanding the soil microbiology and boosting it from a natural perspective? Full growth, full potential plant growth, blooming, fruit production within that plant's genetic limits. So I'm not talking past the limits of wise genetics. So these plants in our gardens are embedded in the ecosystem, and we're looking at doing this for the bigger reason of improving environmental health around us. So we are trying to improve not only our gardens but the ecosystem at large, and it has to do with expanding complexity. Ecosystems are very complex and they're all interrelated and interdependent, and we'll be seeing some of that through the soil biology. And why is that important? Because we are also embedded in this ecosystem. It's not just our gardens out there in our backyards. We're part of that. Our animals are part of that. Our kids play on lawns and crawl through bushes and play in dirt. You know, when they, I don't know if it was the CDC or not, came out with a proclamation that if you want your kids to be healthy and have strong immune systems, let them play in the dirt. Let them play with a dog. Let them be exposed to germs, bacteria, fungi, natural things, so it boosts their immune system. So we're part of, we're embedded in that environmental system outside the door. We're a part of that, and our kids are. And so sustainability in a garden is the same as saying sustainability for us. Besides the fact that everything in our gardens eventually flows downhill or blows downwind and gets other people and other ecosystems involved. So that's another reason why we want to be so very sensitive to what we do to our gardens. So, and it all starts and ends in the soil. So we'll keep going. So this is one of my favorite pictures. It's the Pacific Northwest rainforest, so Douglas fir mostly. We have some around here too, up on the ridge, looks a little bit like this. It's the most productive ecosystem in the world as far as carbon production. And the carbon is measured in board feet. Very complex. And you know, there's no little gardener out there with the little whirly bird fertilizer spray pellets out. Nobody's gardening, nobody's turning the soil over and digging it up, no person. There's animals that do that. Everybody has their job. This is all created because of the soil microbiology. The plants all have their roots in the soil. And our, how do we translate what nature does? Over eons, mind you, some ecosystems take thousands and thousands of years to form the way we see them now. Some ecosystems grow almost overnight in a couple of years, and we'll talk about that. That's called succession. So what do we need to do to our own gardens to get that same abundant benefit? And I've boiled it down. Well, basically, it's working with the soil microbiology. And this is one of those awesome scanning electron micrographs of the surface of a compost pile. I don't have my my laser pointer anymore because my husband drained it playing with the cat. So I'll have to just step over here. I call this my spaghetti and meatballs picture. But this is all biology. So when you look at the surface of a compost pile, you're looking at that material that has not yet completely decomposed, or it has broken down into fine particles. You can't actually see these microbes with the naked eye. So to take this picture with a scanning electron micrograph, they had to coat it with a particular material called gold palladium and then shoot electrons at it to get this bounce back picture. This is 5 micrometers or microns, two different measurements, but it's the same thing. That 1 micron or micrometer is 1/1000th of a millimeter, 1,000. It's about the size, 1 micron, of a single bacterium. There's some, there's a cluster of them. There's some little nice balls over there, the little tiny ones, about 1 micrometer or 1 micron. This big meatball here is a yeast spore. That actually might be something found on the surface of grape skins. So when they make grapes, the yeast is already there on the grape skin. So it's a natural thing that occurs, but it's a single-celled fungi, very different from these filaments here. This is the typical beneficial fungi that knits soils together. And in that forest picture we just had, they have found as much as 10 miles of this fine filamentous fungi per gram of soil. That's about a teaspoon. 10 miles. That blows my mind every time I hear it. That is how present they are in our soils. When you first, the first rain of the season, and you smell that wonderful forest floor smell, it's the fungi waking up in response to the moisture. They're waking up. They have an ability to kind of wall themselves off and put these sticky substances around them and protect themselves for long, long, long dry spells. But when that moisture hits and they begin to wake up and grow, they send out fragrance, those and other microbes, and it's quite lovely. So working with these guys is what we will be doing. Here's another picture. This is just organized as a flow chart. So here we have energy from the sun goes into plants. Plants shed parts of their bodies from the root tips, or when we mow lawns and we prematurely cut the grass off, those clippings, leaves that fall on the forest floor in autumn, all of those waste material, we call it organic matter, dead organic matter. They're decomposed or broken down or recycled. It's the same word, decomposed, broken down, or recycled by only 2 major groups, bacteria and fungi. So this is the dichotomy, the chocolate and vanilla, the male and the female, the black and white of the soil. You have 2 pathways to break materials down, bacteria and fungi. And we'll go on from there because you'll see some, I'll show you. So anyway, this is what supports this recycling of all this stuff that we call waste, from food scraps that we throw away and scrapings off the table and the leftover oatmeal and you name it, the leftover lettuce from the salad. It's all recycled nutrient that goes back into the food web, into the food chain, and ends up eventually feeding us again, especially because the garbage companies are now doing a lot of the recycling of the food waste and composting it and selling it to farmers. So it's getting that loop closer and closer to close, which is great. So this is the system that we're going to be working with. So given that, knowing that we're working with microbes, what are the biggest challenges to most modern gardens? And most of you are going to be looking at, you're going to be thinking of not these challenges, but what do these challenges cause in gardens? So you're going to be more concerned with and looking at the effects. Oh, the grass doesn't grow evenly. Oh, it's spotty. Oh, I'm getting bugs. Oh, their plants are turning yellow. Oh, I'm getting insects. Oh, it's not growing. It's not producing. So much of that has to do with compaction in the soil. And compaction almost always causes anaerobic soil condition. Anaerobic, I wanted to explain what that means. So it basically means without aerobic, so without oxygen. It's systems that are low in oxygen or without any oxygen at all. And that's what happens when we compress soil, we compact it, we take out the air spaces, the pockets of oxygen that these microbes that are in the soil need to breathe and to reproduce and to do their jobs. And there are also air spaces and pockets that during the winter when we get rain and when it's irrigated, hold on to that extra water so it just doesn't drain right through, it holds on. So it's a soil that's more efficient with water holding capacity. So when we compact soils, many different modern reasons for compaction, from athletic fields where kids have to go out and play and they're playing rain or shine, and ball fields are more sensitive when they're wet, they compact easier, so that's an issue. When we have a remodel on our house and you have tractors and compaction material moving right up to the edge of the house, right over where it used to be a garden, that's a problem too. Modern house building codes cause you to compact all of the soil around the site so that you get no settling and shift once the house is built. So then after new houses are built and after remodeling and reconstruction, you end up with garden areas that are extremely compact, where typically maybe 6 inches to a foot of fresh topsoil is laid down on top of that terrible compaction. And the problem doesn't become apparent until the new plants that are put in get down to that compaction zone and try and grow into that. Roots can grow through anything, but it's that anaerobic layer, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. It's that anaerobic layer that causes the problem. The other biggest problem that I see in my years of gardening and observing is low fertility, either because there is a poorly functioning soil food web, so there's not as many microbes creating the nutrient from the raw material. Maybe somebody's been using chemical fertilizers for a long time, pesticides, herbicides, that kind of thing, and it's killed off a good portion of the living soil. Or there's a kind of a misunderstood organic mode where people don't do anything and they think that's organic, and it's actually not. Nature doesn't do nothing. Nature has birds that poop, and nature has animals that come up and dig the soil and do this and that and all kinds of things. So oftentimes when people do nothing at all, it causes low fertility. So I've seen that quite a bit. So either low fertility from not doing anything to salt damage, and another big problem is the nitrates in fertilizers. I was telling you a little bit earlier, they're soluble form. So they move very quickly through the soil horizon with one good rain event or several irrigation events, up to 40 to 60% are the claims, move past the root system and down into groundwater, moving down deeper and deeper into the soil. They never get to benefit the plant. And this is why you need to put chemical fertilizers on a bi-monthly or monthly basis, because it doesn't stick around. The chemical fertilizers don't. So this is Russ Miller Field right out here. This is back in September when I first visited it. And there were two very large noticeable patches that were compacted. You could see the shoe prints from the kids with the little, whatever the bottom of the soccer shoes, cleats, have the little
cleats.
Cleats. You can see the little, they're like plastic cleats, I think, right? They're not metal. You can see those. You can see the compaction effect, and because of that compaction, the soil chemistry and soil biology was thrown off. So, compaction over years of use takes out the air spaces, when the air spaces are taken out, the microbes, the beneficial soil food web microbes that are down there can't breathe. So they breathe oxygen and breathe out carbon dioxide just like you and I. They're the exact same model of metabolism. Oxygen in, carbon dioxide out. So if you can imagine a compaction zone, an analogy might be a 24-hour fitness gym with in a teaspoon of soil there are anywhere between 30,000 and 3 billion soil microbes, predominantly bacteria. So if you imagine a 24-hour fitness gym, close all the doors with about 10,000 people inside and they're all moving around, okay, the microbes are not just laying there doing nothing. They're not laying on a chaise lounge in the soil. They're working, they're moving, they're metabolizing, they're consuming, they're reproducing, so they need this oxygen. And if you did that to all those people in a 24-hour fitness gym, shut the doors, denied any oxygen because you've compacted it, what would happen to those people? They'd pass out first and then they die. And that's exactly what happens to the oxygen-breathing soil biology in the soil. They pass out, they go to sleep, that's what the scientists call it, and what wakes up are those microbes that have adapted to low oxygen environments. Now we need them, okay? Can you imagine the bay? If we didn't have any of those microbes that can work in a water situation in the mud, fish dies and sits in the bottom of the bay in the mud, and nothing's breaking it down because there's no microbes? No, that's not good. But it's that same kind of microbe. It knows how to adapt to a low oxygen environment and it can keep breaking things down. The unfortunate thing is, what is it breaking down into? What is it making? So the good microbes are making the foods exactly what the plants need. Exactly the nutrients that the plants need. The bad guys, the ones that can live in a low oxygen or no oxygen environment, are making, and I think I might have a slide about this, maybe it's later, they're making putrid byproducts. So when we throw garbage out, our green waste bins after a week of 80 degree temperature with food scraps in there, smells pretty bad sometimes, right? Those are the putrid microbes. Those are the microbes that are breaking the food down inside that big chunk of tuna or inside the meat or the butter that went bad or whatever it is, the rind of cantaloupe. They're breaking it down in those low oxygen environments inside that food. Those are the smells. Putrescine, butyric acid is the smell of decomposing butter and rotten milk. Valeric acid is the smell of vomit. And I've actually inspected composting sites, professional composting sites, and it smelled like vomit. And that's one reason this, you know, that we're associated with that we call it vomit, it's really valeric acid, is we have an anaerobic digester. Our system here, anaerobic, we're not full of oxygen. No, it's anaerobic, and that's why we take kombucha and vinegars as digestive aids, because they're all anaerobic byproducts. But plants don't want vinegar. Plants don't want ammonia. Plants don't want those byproducts that those microbes make. So essentially, underneath this, and I don't think this picture shows it quite well, but these areas here that look like it's brown grass, it's actually just dirt. Right underneath the surface. And when I tested with my probe, I could only get down like an inch. And I hit gravel and I hit very compacted soil. So it was kind of proof of why that was the way it was. So we have this anaerobic layer underneath there. It's what nature does. Nature steps in and says, okay, I'm gonna keep life going any way I can. So if you compact it, then I'm gonna bring out these guys that can live there anyway. And what does that do? It attracts grubs. It attracts beetles and other critters to land there. The smell does. We can't smell it, but they can. They can sense it. Land there and actually deposit their young there, their eggs. It attracts birds because they can smell things. They think, this is food. This is where food is. So there were a lot of birds pecking. They may have been going after the grubs that were in there. So it's interesting where somebody might say, oh, I've got grubs in my lawn and it's really bad. It's a patch like this. Really, what's driving that whole system underneath is the compacted soil. So it's the cascade effect. And a lot of times we just look at the symptoms on the surface. Kind of like what we do with headaches and aspirin. We just want to get rid of the headache, but it would be better to find out what was causing the headache. So compaction is one of those big issues, and it's so common in our modern world. So let's see. So this is me. I came in. I have a 250-gallon tank brewer at home that I make the compost tea with in my backyard. It's all professional. I test it frequently. I've been doing this for a little over 10 years. Went through a whole certification process. I even am so particular about it that I make my own compost. I don't rely on anything that's made in any municipal facility because what goes into the compost tea has to be absolutely the best, 100% good microbes, nothing stinky, nothing, nothing like that, because I don't want to have that end up putting it out in the field, you know, with my tea. So I have a 100-gallon skid sprayer that slips in the back of my truck, and my husband and I, who's my mechanic, paste the field out here and set it up into sections, and we spray the whole thing in 20-foot swaths back and forth, walking back and forth, and we put about 200 gallons of material on that whole field. We're going to be doing that three times altogether. This was the first treatment. It was nice and sunny back then. Here's a little bit of improvement that I've seen in about 2 months. This was right at the time I was doing the second spray. You can see the grass beginning to come in. So the spaces in between the tufts of grass are much smaller. And then this one I just took when I came by here on Monday. So it's about the same field. Now, this makes it look better than it really is. There are bare patches of soil, and this is right around the same area, but even after two compost tea treatments and some other beneficial microbes I put on there, it's beginning to grow back in. Why? Because there's this front, like a wave almost, if you will, of microbes moving down into the soil. And the microbes, the good soil food web microbes that I'm applying, as they move down into the soil, are actually consuming the bad guys. They are creating air pockets and space, the living rooms, the dining rooms, the hallways, as they move around and jostle material, they're actually creating the air spaces again in the pockets. Question?
Because of the compaction, would mechanical aeration have sped up the improvement process?
And that's in the works. That's coming, yes. And we started out with an aeration process, although it wasn't my favorite aeration. It wasn't plugging. It takes the plug out, it was just spiking. So, but it at least it's something. But yeah, we're not done yet, so I'm really excited to see the improvements already. Of how to approach this big animal of soil biology is, first off, protect your soil, just like, you know, a physician's code, do no harm. So don't work your soil when it's really, really wet, you know, just, you know, right after a rain or right after you've watered it, let it dry out a bit. Don't work your soil, especially clay, when it's super, super, super bone dry and just goes to powder. You will lose everything that has to do with how the soil crumbs and how it holds together, the aggregation of it. So don't do that. Try not to play and walk on a turf lawn when it's wet, when it's rained. Of course, you know, sometimes you have to, so you'll know what to do. And inoculate with soil biology wherever you can. We'll talk a lot more about that. Nurture the soil biology that you have there. Predominantly, that means stop using chemical fertilizers and learn to nurture with different organic fertilizers and other methods that I'll show you. And then it's matching maintenance practices with the intended plant groups that you have. And that's a little harder to describe, so I'll wait until the slide that's in. So this is funny, apropos to tonight. This is a Swiss chard, and this was just before the San Francisco Flower and Garden Show in 2009. This was one of the plants I was going to put in my garden display, and we had a horrendous frost. And this is the frost, and it didn't hurt the plant at all, because it was so covered with compost tea on the surfaces of the leaves. The soil biology helped protect it. So, funny thing, a lot of people think that's mildew on there. No. So, stop killing the soil food web good guys. Stop using pesticides, herbicides. They all have a non-target kill in the soil. And they're not required to say. They're not even required to test to find out what else it kills. But they all kill some component of the soil food web biology. So, like I was saying, in a teaspoon, scientists call it a gram of soil, but in a teaspoon, there's anywhere between 100,000 and 3 billion bacteria. And typically, they found that in every gram, there's 30,000 different species, 10 to 30,000 different species. And so when you start eroding that diversity of species with regular inputs of chemicals, chemical fertilizers, pesticides, herbicides, it starts to break down that web of life in the soil that supports everything else around it. So, and also, I really want you to know that the inorganic or chemical fertilizer use is not good. And we've kind of turned a blind eye to that, but it also has a hand in eroding the soil biology as well. Particularly the nitrogen component that they use in chemical fertilizers, the soluble component, is soluble because it is in a salt form. So we know salt, table salt, NaCl, sodium chloride, is in a soluble form, meaning when you put it in water, it dissolves completely, allowing it to move through whatever you put it on, in your body, over food, whatever. So too is the nitrates and other nitrogen forms that they put in soluble chemical fertilizers. It's in a salt form, so it can move readily through the soil horizon to get to your roots. If it just stayed up on the surface, you know, they couldn't make these claims that, wow, it makes a wonderful pop. I hear from gardeners all the time, I want that pop of green. That's the chemical. It's chemical moving right down in 3 or 4 days of rain or irrigation into the roots and just pushing its chemical nature by osmotic pressure into the plant. The plant has no choice. It just has to take it in. There's no microbe interaction, no partnership. None of that. It's a chemical domination. And it does kill, from the saltiness, many of the microbes as it's moving through the soil horizon. Many of the nitrate-loaded fertilizers are twice as salty as table salt. So table salt, NaCl, is kind of the basic index. That's saltiness of 1. And many of them are salt index of 2. They're twice as salty as table salt. We all, I think, know enough that salt is a terrible thing to put on the ground. It's awful. I knew that from when I was a little kid and my brothers used to pour salt on snails. Oh, it does terrible things to life. So we need to stop doing that and slowly shift over. So another thing.
You went right by the alkalinity and acidity of the soil. We live in a very alkaline territory.
Uh-huh.
And you're saying here not to try to adjust the pH?
Yes.
Because
from a chemical point of view, so this is another form of chemical domination. Thank you for pointing that out. So lime is one that's generally used most often in agricultural systems. So I'm actually going to focus on the acid food component. How many of you have heard of acid food? So it's a chemical fertilizer to which sulfur has been added to drop the pH chemically of the soil that you put it on. And the claim is that azaleas, camellias, and rhododendrons, now also blueberries have been added to that list, like to have an acidic soil. And if you're from an area that doesn't have soil acidity, if your pH is above 7 or above 8, then you can't grow those plants. When you actually use sulfur as an agent to chemically drop the pH and manipulate the pH that way, sulfur is one of the most efficient fungicides. So remember that picture of the soil biology? So this is what the soil looks like in a forest system. In an old growth forest system where rhododendrons, azaleas, camellias, and blueberries thrive. And I might also say strawberries on the edge of that forest. They thrive in that system. And it's this fungi, as it's breaking down bits and pieces of bark and leaves and other carbon materials, squirts out a tiny microscopic amount of organic acid. That's how it breaks carbon bonds apart. And let me tell you, it breaks any carbon bond apart from wood to oil. A famous mycologist was in town when the Costco Busan oil spill hit, and he sopped up some oil, took it up to the Presidio composting facility, and did an experiment where they used fungal spores of oyster mushrooms to break down the oil, and they ended up growing oyster mushrooms this big, to which everyone said when they saw them, oh darn, too bad they're full of petroleum byproducts, we can't eat them. So he took a sample, sent it into a lab, and it was perfect, beautiful oyster mushroom, only, you know, 5 times bigger than what you would get at Safeway. So they are experts at taking down any carbon bonds. And they do it with organic acids. And that causes a slow buildup of acidity in forest soils because of the action of its soil partner. So azaleas, camellias, and rhododendrons, and blueberries, and many other plants, because they originated in a forest system, no matter where that forest system is in the world, that's where they grew up and evolved, prefer that acidic soil for that reason. Not chemically induced acidity, but acidity that's induced from soil biology. And you can get around growing those plants, even if you have a pH of 7.5 to 8, by adding well-made compost and using a wood chip mulch that eventually breaks down from the action of the fungi, rather than killing the partner in the soil that actually creates the acidity, using the acid food component, the sulfur. Better to put the soil biology on there and create that microcosm in the soil around the plant that you want to grow.
What is the timeline when you do that?
Timeline could be over a couple of seasons. And when you plant the plant, you put, if you're working with a system that starts with a really alkaline soil, then you use more well-made compost. And you plant that plant, you put maybe 50% of it in the planting hole and mix it with your existing soil. And then you get an instant change. And as the roots grow out, they're actually growing with the partnership of the fungi. So that's how you actually change your soil from a biological perspective. So oftentimes it all comes down to using compost, which, let me find where I was. Okay, that line there. So, changing, adding lime to change your alkalinity, to increase your alkalinity or to produce calcium in your soil, it's the same way. It ends up being a salt-like effect that kills a lot of the soil biology. Better to use a more raw food. If calcium is what you're after, what about oyster shell? You know, in nature, it's bird bones and animal bones. They break down, the plant's roots find them, the microbes, the mycorrhizal fungi find it, break it down, and bring the nutrient right back to the plant. So there's lots of different ways of doing it. It's these refined products that release their power immediately and chemically dominate the system and kill part of the soil biology. That's what we're trying to get away from. Because then you've just ruined your whole natural ecosystem in the soil. So another thing that also causes damage to the soil food web is, well, the compaction that we talked about earlier, and the compaction promoting the anaerobic conditions, and the plant toxins that those make. Oh, alcohol is another big one. Alcohol is made by what? Those yeast spores that we saw in that picture. So yeast spores in water with nice, rich, sweet nutrient, grape juice, apple juice, whatever you have it, bingo, alcohol is made. It does the same thing in the soil. If you have those yeast spores and they're everywhere, you're actually making alcohol. And when a root grows down, like I said earlier, roots can grow through rock. But when it hits a layer, a zone, where anaerobic byproducts are proliferating, it can't grow through alcohol. Alcohol will dissolve it. It's the single most toxic ingredient to plant tissue. It will dissolve it. And so if you really carefully pull a plug of turf out of these compacted areas and gently wash off the soil, you will look and see ragged brown bottoms of roots. And it's literally being burnt, chemically burnt by the anaerobic byproducts. Alcohol, vinegar, valeric acid, putrescine, all of those. Unnecessary cultivation and rototilling is another thing that damages a lot of soil food web microbes. I'm not saying no-till. I'm not a believer in no-till. There's a reason to till, and we'll talk about that a little later. And like I said earlier, never, never, never work the soil when it's extremely wet or extremely dry. So, number two in my list of four most important things is inoculate the soil. If you've damaged your soil in any way, you want to bring more soil food web microbes in. Compost is the single most effective product. I believe in making your own. Of course, teaching the Master Composter program for 10, 12 years, and being a master composter for 4 years before that, I really believe in making your own compost because you can make a better product than anything you can buy in a bag or from, you know, the big bulk places, especially anything that comes in stinky. If it causes those little muscles at the base of your nose to begin to crinkle, that is you are hardwired biologically to protect yourself from putrid things. Your nose is saying, don't get that putrid thing close to my mouth. You're not going to eat it, you'll get sick. Well, if you smell compost really intimately and that begins to happen, know that it's gone putrid. Not enough oxygen in the composting process. It's really common. So just know how to use it. Never put stinky hot compost in the ground. Don't put it in the planting hole, just use it on the surface. Let it off gas, let it return to a natural state and go back to being, you know, a little bit cleaner and better for the plants. Compost is the best. And then mycorrhizal fungi, the next slide talks a little bit more about that, or the slide after this. It is recently discovered, I think about 30 to 50 years ago, and now science has advanced enough so that there are some spores of mycorrhizal fungi that they can grow in pure culture, package and sell so you can buy. And this is a fungi that grows only in the partnership with other plants. And I've got a great picture to show you. You need to understand the difference between the two basic kinds they sell. There's many kinds, but they're only able to grow in pure culture, two basic kinds. The last thing is using actively aerated compost tea. Now, because I am a tea producer, I don't like people to think that I'm tooting my own horn. Compost tea is a tool, it's not a rule. It's just another way to put compost out in a garden to get the microbes in your garden. So sometimes it's difficult in a beautifully landscaped garden to throw compost out. You don't want that material there. You don't want to see it. Compost tea is now another way to do it. So it's just another way to get compost out there. These are some of the beneficial reactions from compost. Provides the perfect plant food through the interaction of the decomposing material and the microbes that are there. No side effects, no ground pollution. Nutrient cycling in a continuous process takes it right to the root. Compost improves the physical structure, whether it's sand, silt, or clay. It improves the physical structure of all soils through the actions of the soil food web microbes. Reduces runoff and erosion, reduces compaction over time. It's a little bit of a slow process, but it does it. It balances the soil chemistry. It buffers the pH. So it's great for doing that. You have to get a good compost, not stinky. So smell it. Bring your cocoa. Bring your chocolate bar, 70% cacao. Hold it up. It should be that dark brown color, never black. Never, it shouldn't smell like something burnt. And compost supports plant immune systems as well. Just like a third or two-thirds of our immune system is here in our intestine, in the plants, it's down in the root system and the interaction with the beneficial microbes. So, inoculate your soil with mycorrhizal fungi. Mycorrhizal is the Greek word for fungus root. So, a little redundant, fungus root fungus. But there are two basic kinds, endo and ecto. Sorry, this gets a little technical. You can buy a blend of both of them. It comes in a package, it looks like dust, or they glump it together, and it's a little pebbles, kind of, granular form, they call it. But it's basically the spores. How many of you have ever picked a wild mushroom cap and put it down on a sheet of paper, and you get a spore print? It's really quite beautiful. Those are the spores that color the paper, so it's the spores that they've learned how to grow. So you get a package and you're actually buying the spores of these particular types of fungi. You must get it to touch the roots. So at planting time is really the most effective time to introduce it to your plant's root system. You cannot sprinkle it on the surface and expect it to filter down through our heavy clay soil. It won't do it. And there's a lot of products that they sell that say, oh, just put it on the surface, sprinkle it on, and it'll, no, it won't benefit your roots. You should know that. If you live in Florida and 100% sand, maybe, but not here. So putting it on your plants when you're transplanting is the most effective time. The reason the plant needs to touch the roots is that, remember the exudates I talked about, the nutrient leaking out the roots? It's a lock and key mechanism. That exudate wakes up the spore. Otherwise, the spore will sit in the ground dormant forever and not wake up, because it only lives in partnership with a plant. So it wakes up in response to the exudates and says, hi, okay, and it grows right into the root. Just like up my sleeve, it just grows right into the plant's root and then moves out from there anywhere between 18 inches and 3 or 4 feet. And it spreads out that much, different lengths for different plants and different mycorrhizal fungi. But it's been shown to boost the root system by as much as 40% of plants. So you increase plant root systems by 40%, you get 40% more nutrition coming into that plant. That's like if we had 40% more hands. No, it's not quite a right analogy. But anyway, so it really is a great thing. It occurs naturally, but in our gardens, we don't have natural systems. We plant them, chemical people in nurseries grow the plants. They don't add these at that time. So we've damaged our ecosystems in our gardens so much that oftentimes they don't exist anymore. The good thing is, once you put them in once, you don't need to put them in ever again, because then they grow into the ecosystem and they're part of that. The difference between the endo and the ecto is in the type of plant. So most plants that we have in our gardens prefer the one called endo. Endomycorrhizal fungi, or VAM. vesicular, arbuscular mycorrhizal fungi. Some labels actually say that. And there's lots of great websites that you can go to get more information on this and a complete listing of plants, which ones like which. Mycorrhizal applications. So mycorrhizalapplications.com is the website. They're the largest producers. The ecto is for conifers, is for oaks, and a very few other native plants that grow in this area. So it's a much smaller group, only for these really old growth, older plants. Pansies, daisies, lettuce, carrots, status, salvias, all those like the endo. So that's the most common one that we would all use. One thing you should know, never, 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 never use them on any vegetable in the kale or brassica family, the mustard family. Cabbage, kale, Brussels sprouts, broccoli, those guys don't want anything to do with fungi at all, at all. Broccoli, no. Lettuce, yes. Broccoli in that family called the mustard family, Brassicaceae. So know your kale vegetables. Brussels sprouts, kohlrabi, all of those. Don't want anything to do with that. Nature has to be a little complicated sometimes. So here is mycorrhizal fungi. The black is the root of the plant, and this is actually an ecto mycorrhizal fungi. Look at how beautiful it is. Early, early, early on, that's what they called root hairs. Scientists thought this was root hairs, but it's actually a whole nother animal. A completely, it's in its own kingdom. Fungi are in their own kingdom now. They're not plants. So it's this alien invader coming in to symbiotically help plants. It's lovely because this plant here is sending messages chemically saying, I need a little bit of water, and while you're out there getting me some water and you're pumping it back to me, I want some phosphorus and potassium, and can you get me a little nitrogen? And fungi grows out there, finds that stuff, pulls it into its hollow tube, and ships it back to the plant. And the plant says, well, thank you so much, here, I'll give you a little bit of sugar I need. And mycorrhizal fungi says, oh, thank you, this is a good partnership. And it goes on from there. It's amazing what it does. So, stage three, nurture. So we protect, we inoculate, and now we nurture what we've already put in there. And how many of you have heard that old expression? I think the guys at Rodale, the organic gardening guys, that magazine started this, feed the soil, not the plant. It's actually feed the microbes, because then the microbes process it, just like what happens in our digestive systems. The microbes process all that raw organic matter and feed it right to the plant in the perfect ratio that the plant wants, in the perfect amount. So very much like what the media, the health media is telling us, you've all heard of the caveman diet now. It's raw food, raw food. So we want to give our plants raw food because we want the microbes to break that down and feed the plant. So this actually makes it a lot easier. I did want to let you know that sometimes on some of the organic fertilizers, they put a tiny bit of soluble nitrogen in there. And that's just a little tiny bit. It should be below 2 to 3%. Gone are the days when there's like 30% soluble nitrogen. Oh my goodness. So 2 to 3% is fine. It's so small, it's in balance with the soil system. And the soil food web microbes must process all that stuff. Whether it's oyster shell for calcium or it's alfalfa meal. So alfalfa is what we feed horses and cattle, and it's rich in nitrogen because it's a legume. So it's in the pea and bean family, and it has a little microbe that works with it to take N2. So 76% of the air that we're breathing is nitrogen in the form of two molecules fused together, is completely inert, doesn't react with anything. We just react with the nitrogen, 26% nitrogen, 24% nitrogen. What? The microbe that lives on the roots of all leguminous plants, peas, beans, soybeans, all of those plants, even acacia plants, Do you ever wonder why acacias grow so well when you don't do anything? Because they have this microbe that takes nitrogen out of the air, breaks that bond apart, and now it's mineralized nitrogen that it can use to grow better. So leguminous plants have a natural benefit from soil biology, gives them more nitrogen in their tissue, and that's why they have more protein. We tend to use those plants as our protein substitutes because they have that nitrogen pool available to them that most plants don't have. Again, soil biology coming in and doing something really cool. So again, nurture your soil. So this is mulching. Mulch is probably the single most effective, simple thing you can do is cover that bare surface of soil with some kind of raw organic material, whether it's the grass clippings from your lawn in thin layers or wood chips from the arborist, wood chips that you buy, or compost. Compost is kind of like the high-end Cadillac or Mercedes of all mulches because it's already broken down and it's not only going to give the raw material, but it's also going to give a high level of microbes back into your soil. So compost is a great thing to use. There's many, many, many other composts. One thing I will mention is if you have a pathway somewhere where you don't want things to grow, that's where you should use ground up redwood, redwood bark, cedar, eucalyptus, camphor, all of those plants that have those volatile oils that, you know, we use for antimicrobial situations, pine salt, antimicrobial, it cleans, kills germs. Well, we don't want to use those in our gardens because it's going to have a dampening effect for the life in the garden and the plants all around it. Put those on your pathway. So, and there's a lot of products that they sell that are actually ground up redwood from the forest industry up north, and it's not the best. So this is actually just up on the ridge, and this is nature's mulch. So bay leaves and oak leaves, and see that little filamentous white stuff there? That's a beautiful fungi growing, decomposing and taking the nutrients out of those leaves and sending it down into the roots that are down below there. And the same thing happens with wood chip mulch in your garden. There's that fine filamentous fungi breaking it down and turning it into a food for the plants that are around it. So here's number four. So this was the match your maintenance practices to your intended plant groups. It's a little bit of a complicated concept, but I wanted to include it. It's called soil succession or plant succession. And here, I'm going to try and explain it. So basically, here, you remember, what was it, 25, maybe 30 years ago now, Yellowstone had that big fire, horrible fire. I mean, it actually turned the silica sand into glass in some places. It was so hot, wiped out all the vegetation. And in some places, it took quite a while for things to come back. What can recover more quickly. So the soil biology was also killed in the top couple inches of the soil from the heat. Plants won't grow without that partnership of soil biology in the wild. What can replace itself and recover more quickly is the bacteria component in the soil. It knows how to grab up nutrients and start to grow itself much more quickly than the fungi. The fungi is the tortoise and the bacteria is the hare. And they reproduce much more quickly. So you get annual plants growing. The wildflowers came back a couple years later. That was because of the proliferation of the bacteria coming back into the soil food web system, supporting and taking the nutrients and feeding it to the plants that were growing. Before that, nothing was growing. Slowly over the years, you start to see the conifers peeking back in and the bunch grasses, which are perennial. So those plants that are longer lived than just annuals, grow and die in 1 year, they prefer a higher balance of fungi. So the nutrients that they get from that ratio of bacteria and fungi, which has to do with the length of time after some kind of disturbance, they prefer a little bit more fungi. And old growth forests haven't been disturbed in how many eons? They like the maximum amount of fungi. A ratio, let's see, turf lawns, generally considered annual plants, you can disturb them, they appreciate being disturbed. They like to be plugged, it helps them, it disturbs it, it kills some of the fungi and proliferates some of the bacteria. They like a one-to-one ratio of mass of bacteria to mass of fungi. Sorry, this is a little complicated, so if it's, you know, over your head, just let it blow off, but I'm trying to kind of set a stage. In an old growth forest, there may be 200 to 1,000 times more fungi than bacteria mass. That much more. So the influence of the fungi is amazing in an old growth forest, amazing in any forest with the acid that it squirts out and the effect on the soil to acidify it. And that's why plants proliferate that like that acidity in that environment so well. So soil succession is the ability of the plant to respond to the bacteria to fungal ratios in there. When we disturb anything, whether it's a fire, a flood, a landslide, or rototilling, we start that succession process all over again. Because when you rototill, you slice and dice and kill most of the fungi. Boom, they're bleeding all their self-sap and all their nutrients that they were pumping back to the plant in their hollow tube bodies. That's all spilled out into the soil. And now the bacteria that survived are like, yum, 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 look at all this, I'm gonna grow really fast. So you're creating an annual system right away. The longer you wait after disturbing it, 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, the older succession level, the better that soil will grow older plants. So remember I was talking about brassicas, broccoli. How many of you like growing broccoli and cabbage and wonderful plants to grow? Kale, can't get enough of kale. And it doesn't get damaged in frost, by the way. All my kale is still standing. All the lettuce, everything else, cilantro is just gone with the frost this morning. So, they prefer to be disturbed. They don't want any fungi at their roots at all. So if you have a broccoli bed, Brussels sprouts, collards, whatever, till that soil. Till it every year. Turn it over. So I believe in not no-till, but knowing when to till and what plants prefer that. If you're growing perennials, if you're growing a butterfly garden or a hummingbird garden with salvias, don't till your soil. They're long-lived plants. They live 7 to 15 years. So they don't want that disturbance. They want that buildup of the fungi in the soil food web and all of the benefits that that can bring. So hopefully I've given you a snippet of a really complicated concept, soil succession, and all of them. But here again is that flow chart. By the way, this is from a publication that Dr. Ingham was the major contributor and the editor for. And it was published by the National Resource Conservation Council. And I think the state of Ohio, if I'm not wrong. This is Soil Biology Primer. It's probably the best book to explain everything about the soil food web, how it works, how it congregates, all the different microbes all the way up to worms and centipedes. It's like a little National Geographic book. The pictures are awesome. It was published, I think, 20 years ago. It's now been given to the people because it was paid for with your tax dollars. It was a government agency, so you can now get a free PDF download by Googling or whatever you use. Soil Biology Primer PDF. So it's a great book. This picture comes from that book. So here is, this is also from the book, here is the scientist flow chart. This is the same thing as the one before, but take away the pictures, it doesn't look so friendly. This will give you an idea of the complexity of just the microscopic portion of the soil food web. Bacteria and fungi, this is all of the benefits that bacteria and fungi in the soil do. Decomposes dead organic matter in the soil or in a compost pile. It digests, converts, and accumulates the nutrients stored in their body mass as protein of the bacteria and fungi. This is a non-soluble form, so unlike chemical fertilizers, rain comes, it doesn't leach them out. They stay stuck in the soil until the poop loop effect. We'll show you that very quickly. So here's a scanning electron micrograph of a predominantly bacterial compost. So only fungi you see are these little strappy guys here. All the rest, well, these are the yeasts again. All the rest are bacteria in that picture. So bacteria and fungi make sticky glues that hold themselves into the substrate. So you know when you leave that science experiment, the leftover Chinese food in the back of your refrigerator, you know, my husband used to do this. I have to say this because it brings it home, how sticky bacteria are. He, before we got married, he used to dip his finger in that and spread his fingers apart to see if it formed a thread. That's how he would tell if it was okay to eat. He almost died twice. And then I came along and I have a sensitive nose and I understand bacteria and soil food web. We brush our teeth because bacteria stick to that surface and here. And so bacteria make glues that stick them into the environment. But those glues also create adhesion. Sand, silt, and clay particles get gently stuck together because of their stickiness. That creates the first micro aggregation. And then fungal threads, miles of them in small amounts of soil, thread those together and form macro aggregates. It's called a crumb structure. And it's a beautiful thing when you have that crumb structure in the soil, hold it together. The opposite would be if you picked up a handful of dry sand and it just runs out. Doesn't hold anything, doesn't hold nutrients either. So these are the qualities, the fungal threading, like quilt threading, and the stickiness of the bacterial glues are the things that reduce and mitigate erosion, that hold nutrients in. Quite amazing what they do. So again, same picture. Here's a picture of a fungally dominant compost. That's the one we saw before. Here we're going to move from this group, fungi and bacteria, into the group that eats the fungi and bacteria. So we're moving up the food chain. In the soil, it's so complex, it's called a web. So it's the soil food web. Protozoan nematodes, they eat the bacteria and fungi. And what happens whenever anything eats? This is the point you get to say the funny word where everyone giggles and they wake up. Poops. Poop happens. So it's via the poop loop. Their movement in the soil creates pore space, brings back the oxygen spaces that we need, also helps hold and cause a soil to be more water holding efficient. So mitigates compaction. So here's some, these are protozoa. This is a big bacterial feeding nematode. This is a nematode, big jaws. Grabs those little bacteria, chomps them up, and pulls them into its body, poops out the nutrient that's perfect for plants. Here's a nematode that's eating another nematode. Here's the poop loop chart, which I developed because when I was teaching the master composters, the nitrogen cycle is there. The chemical nitrogen cycle is rather complex. And at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, for a bunch of non-professionals, they would fall asleep. So I developed the poop loop and everyone got happy and laughed and woke up. It's basically living plants make dead organic matter, decomposed, and that material is grabbed and held onto by the bacteria and fungi. It's stabilized. And then the microscopic predators begin to eat it, and every time they eat something, they poop, and it's a release of nitrogen right back to the living plant. That's and also all the other nutrients that are inherent in what they're consuming. But that is the beauty of nutrient cycling, or recycling, we might call it, in the soil. I won't go through this, but this is the scientist's molecular rendition of exactly how much is created per protozoa in molecules of nitrogen per gram per plant proving that you actually do make enough nitrogen from the nutrient cycling in compost and soil food web functioning. You don't need to be dumping a lot of chemical fertilizer. So here's another nematode eating a thread of fungi and sucking the juice out from it. Here's a little habitat side view. It takes about 5 minutes to fully explain this, but basically if you can shrink this down to the size of a head of a pin or smaller, these are all the little guys that are moving around. He knows that there's some good yummies in there he wants to eat. He may be not much bigger than 50 micrometers in size, but he's gonna move those little bits of sand, silt, and clay aside and get in there and eat. You know, when we're hungry, we'll do almost anything. When you have 50,000 or 2 or 3 million or 2 or 3 billion of these microbes per teaspoon of soil, every teaspoon in your garden, if it's healthy, doing just that, it makes a difference. It's not just one or two kind of floating around here or there. There is a prodigious amount of soil biology in this, in healthy soils. Some of us don't have as many. So it makes a difference, and this is how air pockets and air spaces are created from the movement of the microbes. This is the next to last slide. This is a demonstration. So this is a nematode. It was in a compost sample. So I'm the judge for San Mateo County's compost fertility competition every year. And I look at every single sample under the microscope. So I'm looking at 400 power. This is about 400 power. And you're seeing a lot of different bits of minerals and things and some other microbes in there. But this is basically, this is the business end down there. And he's, or she, is grazing in, eating bacteria down in the compost substrate. And you can see inside his gut. He's eating at that end, and all of the squished up bacteria are moving towards the end. And that's how nutrient cycling happens. It gets put back out into the soil in a micro but soluble form from the back end of these microbes. So that's basically it. I wanted to really acknowledge and thank Dr. Elaine Ingham, a world famous microbiologist and the originator of soil food web. It was research that came from her doctoral thesis back in 85, hers and her husband's and a couple other scientists as well, that set this all in motion. And she was the person that coined the phrase, the soil food web. An amazing person who works tirelessly for healthy soil life.